Initiation. Before I left Beas, Mrs. Johnson arranged an interview with Maharaji, during which she made a strong representation that, except for the diet problem, I was in every other way quite ready for initiation. In high good humor, she rallied the master, begging that I be given at least one of the five names granted at initiation. He was greatly amused at her ingenuous demand. With affection for her shining in his eyes, he had bestowed on her the epithet Gur Piyari, beloved of the master. He laughingly said, "If I give her one, I may as well give her all five." To which she quickly responded, "Then give her all five." "But she's still eating meat," he replied. "Never mind, that is not her fault. She doesn't want to eat it," she pleaded whilst I stood by, begging with my eyes for all I was worth. "Very well. When I pass through Delhi later on, we shall see," he said, seeming to relent. And so it came to pass. But beloved of the master had by then been gathered by the master for his heavenly garden. She passed away in February in the hospital at Lahore. And in March the master, once more visiting Colonel Sanders' bungalow in Delhi, bade me attend him there, and I had the five names given to me. During the following summer, having contracted a form of fibrositis, I consulted a doctor who, I knew, would prescribe a meatless diet as a part of the cure. My parents met the new approach with a twinkle in their eyes. My mother remarked, "You are very much in earnest about this philosophy, aren't you?" and indicated they would no longer obstruct my wishes if the treatment did not affect my health adversely. Of course, the experiment was successful, as I was prescribed a carefully balanced and wholesome diet, an introduction to vegetarianism few people experience. Whilst on leave in October, I journeyed to Beas with the colonel for the second part of my initiation, to which there was now no obstacle. This was the more significant half of the instruction, the true initiation when the master actually links the soul with the sound current. I well remember an agonizing repayment of karma made 24 hours beforehand, perhaps one of the most disabling migraine headaches I had ever suffered. The colonel and dear Rani Rajwadi had practically to carry me into the master's presence that day of days. But with what exaltation of spirit, I will not here enlarge upon. I often marvel at the ease with which he absorbed me into his fold, the first British woman, young and reserved, to seek initiation at his hands. He fitted me most naturally into his scheme of things, sponsored, for my parents' comfort, by an officer of the same service to which my father belonged. Entertained by a kindly American woman who treated me with the greatest affection from the moment we first met, and godmothered by a charming and cultured Indian lady who gave me support during my final initiation. What love you bestowed on me, my beloved master, in even the smallest detail of my advent to your feet. During the course of the same year, Rai Sab Harnarayan, Maharaji's secretary, had passed to a better life. In accordance with custom, when a year had elapsed, a memorial service was held in the main hall of the colony, the Satsangar, presided over by the master. Colonel Martin had joined Colonel Sanders and myself at the Dera, and we all three attended the service. It was a bright afternoon, and the sun streamed in through the open doors. Not many people were present, only the basic staff usually resident at the Dera, and a few Indian visitors. Later, we compared our reactions, and all to whom we spoke felt the same sense of elation and transport. The scene, already colorful and bright, seemed to take on added intensity, as though a rainbow had been thrown over it all. Each one's face appeared as though it glowed with health and happiness. and the master was suffused with a kind of nimbus of bright sunshine and color. Not unnaturally so, but as though all accustomed processes of life had been increased well beyond the usual mortal bounds. A radiant feeling of happiness remained after we left the hall, and continues to this day in my memory. At the end of this holiday, I had to return to duty earlier than my companions. In those days, as you may remember, dear master, the train seldom stopped at Beas on its journey from Lahore to Delhi, and to ensure my berth, it was necessary to go by slow train to Lahore and to board the frontier mail from there. This entailed leaving Beas in the early evening before Satsang had finished. I had Maharaji's previous permission to slip away quietly when the time came, and accordingly, at the appointed moment, rose to do so. Azur paused in what he was saying, and smiling at me, said, "Why do you want to hurry away?" Seeing my troubled look, nonplussed as I was at this unexpected invitation, he said gently, "Very well, you had better go." I left, but what was my chagrin when, with myself aboard, the fast train to Delhi drew to an unscheduled halt on arriving at Beas station from the direction of Lahore, and stopped quite long enough to have allowed me to have boarded it in comfort. Indeed, I could sorrowfully visualize myself coming in at the compartment door, as I would have done had I shown instant faith by taking the master at his word. I hope I have learned from this to be completely and immediately flexible in his hands at any given moment when he indicates a line of action or thought, however improbable it may seem.